you. Well, thank you first of all for the invitation. I had a really nice seminar yesterday with students. I was impressed that they were here, basically. They were still here, around, and active. And it was also a nice opportunity for me to talk about fieldwork that I left behind. And today, with you here, it's really a privilege to be able to talk about fieldwork that I'm doing. So I like, I told Agnieszka yesterday, I really like this kind of overview, managing to get through things I've done and I'm doing and think through them together with you and also yesterday with the students. This is, I just give you a very brief introduction to what will be a very specific paper maybe. I have been working on religion in the socialist and post-socialist context, so especially on Eastern Christians, Greek Catholic, Orthodox and Russian believers, and my questions have mostly been about religious transmissions, how a religious transmission, how ritual, beliefs, change in relation and communities, change in relation to changing political regimes, and I have done both historical and ethnographic work, and after much of this work, I have decided, I took advantage, in fact, of a project that I've done with several other colleagues, an SSRC-funded project on prayer in Eastern churches, to move to think more broadly about questions of transmission in Orthodoxy, and move to do fieldwork in South India. And this choice was not easy, but it was it fits in two ways my research. First of all, I found this strange group of people that I'm going to talk about, which are Syrian Christians in South India, an indigenous community claiming to have been baptized by, converted by Saint Thomas the Apostle in the very first century. Saint Thomas, who is allegedly also was also killed later by a Hindu in neighboring Tamil Nadu. So in a sense, I'm sticking to my questions about Orthodoxy and trying to do an even broader historical, to have a broader historical perspective. The old believers are only 300 years old, so these guys at least claim to have been much older in India, but also to do something that I talked a bit yesterday about it in the seminar on post-socialism, to try to make this bring a dialogue between post-socialist and post-colonial literature in terms of religion. And I have been particularly interested in that because in the socialist and post-socialist context, and again I talked yesterday about it, and in the same way in the colonial context, you have a strong connection between the colonial, the modernizing projects, whether colonial or socialist atheism, as educative projects or education, pedagogies of the state, and the way the state wants to use, wants to transform individuals. And the response to that in both contexts, especially, and there's a lot of literature in the colonial context, especially the literature on colonial education, missionary education, and is very much taken from this perspective of the transformation that such big projects, modernizing projects, wanted to make in local communities and with indigenous subjects, let's call them, strangely, in a strange language. And I have been always interested to look at how could these people, beyond discussions, and this is what we talked about yesterday, beyond issues of resistance, of this kind of resistance response, like pragmatic responses and deceit, that local communities did, how they could actually appropriate these means and transform them and use them for their own good. And this is why my project, in light of this discussion, both the issue of transmission, how religious groups take care to transmit their practices and beliefs, and from the other perspective of how they respond or take over pedagogies and pedagogical means and use them for their own purposes, I look at pedagogies of prayer. A very basic thing that inform my work is also the way religion, Orthodoxy, which is at least in the Byzantine, Eastern Orthodox churches, are extremely localized, and they come from this kind of modeling where the polity and religion or church work together very well, to Oriental Orthodoxy, like the Syrian Christians in India or the Ethiopian or the Coptic Church, where you have a stronger interactions with colonial missionaries, but you also have a global imagination of what this Orientalism means. I'm working for that. For example, I'm working on this kind of projects in the Cold War period, on how they could establish a whole Oriental church project, and how the Cold War allowed them to do that. So in this sense, I'm trying to connect the two orthodoxies, but also the two socialism and colonialism, and the two posts. Let me think about it. I'm using today. I want to talk about one specific aspect in related to these pedagogies of prayer on which I work, which is a transformation, a moment of transformation within religious education. And one of the fascinating, probably, so most of you who have been in Poland are quite familiar with catechism classes, right, and Sunday schools. I coming from a research on rational believers, for example, Eastern Orthodox, it has been quite new to me to encounter the Protestant forms of education, right, in the Sunday schools, and it's very much the research very much plays on this kind of ritual pedagogies versus formalized pedagogies. And it allows me to move from govern, like basically pedagogy as a mode of governing and shaping cities, good citizens, to pedagogy as a way of thinking about how knowledge and intention and what can be known and what cannot be known. Mysteries and so with more epistemological issues, and in my work I shift registers like that between these. So I'll use a girl whom I like a lot today as for the purpose of this discussion, Alicia, whom this 3 years ago I sat in a room when I started my field work in this community. I sat in a small room at the YMCA headquarters in Kota, in Ernakulam, listening to her, to a 13-year-old girl, speaking about the place of God in her life. She was standing in front of two judges, one who was from the Martoma Church, the other one who was from YMCA, with her. It was a small audience, and her mom was in attendance, as she always is. The center was hosting that day. It was one of the first time I went to a Sunday school competition, and the center was hosting that day the inter-Sunday school competition for Ernakulam, for the city, where representatives of eight churches from the city gathered to compete. It was really a full day from morning till evening, with different sections where children competed, included Bible quiz, elocutions, word drill, and group singing in English and Malayalam. Participants came from traditional churches. Maybe I'll sit down. It might be easier. Participants came from traditional churches, among them the Syrian Orthodox, Jacobite, Martoma, Latin Catholics, and Church of something. The other, there were no evangelical Christians who came to the meeting. They were not invited, in fact. And Alicia was competing in the elocution section together with 15 other students. And she had done before that day the Bible quiz competition. You'll see a bit this a bit further on. And the topic was witnessing Jesus in the modern world.
Somebody.
Are they singing Christmas carols or religious songs?
It's nice.
So the topic was witnessing Jesus in the modern world, and it was this kind of spontaneous extempore or spontaneous speech. Yes, so they received a few minutes, 5 minutes before the competition, they received the topic, and they had 3 minutes. They had to improvise a speech on the spot and 3 minutes to say it. So it was a pretty intense competition. And while extemporary speeches are spontaneous, they also have to follow a certain structure, starting with a Bible quote, marked with an example from their own life, and ending with a moral lesson or a message, yes, that they have to give, and refers directly to the topic. And Alicia started out a bit hesitantly, saying, "Oh, the modern world offers many improvements, but keeps us away from God, and from church, and in order to be successful in our life, we need to stay close to God." And her example was even more awkward, because she started to talk about this friend of hers, a neighbor, who was brilliant in everything she did and top in school, but she died young of a brain tumor. And she claimed it was because she had a life without God that her life ended so quickly and kind of was not accomplished, despite the fact that she was an amazing girl. And it was a bit of a strange, example. So the conclusion was that one needs again to be close to God to succeed in life. And her speech was in English. Some of them were speaking Malayalam, others were speaking English. I asked her afterwards, "So how come did you get to this this example?" And she said, "Well, I couldn't find a better example than one from my own life. So I just brought this." What struck me, however, here was the fact that the apparent lack of confidence in her words. So I knew Alicia, and I have seen her, and later on I witnessed. She's a very outspoken girl, a person who is very confident on what she says, and she had a pretty good experience, of public speech. In fact, she was the top in her Sunday school and one of the best in the church. She was also conversant in religious matters, dedicated to her parish church, and fully involved in its activities, from Sunday school, so choir to church fairs, competitions. Now, I have followed Alicia during many other rehearsals and Sunday school competitions, which she won with another well-prepared speech. And I will call this the failed speech and the other one the successful speech. And my talk will be around these two, the failed and the successful speeches. The contrast between her YMCA performance, however, and the others remained very strong. Why did she fail to produce a convincing testimony about her own experience of God, while on so many occasions she proved very persuasive and extremely successful? And I want to take Alicia's failed speech as an opportunity to reflect on the contradictory ways in which Orthodox interiorities are shaped in contemporary South India. So how children become Christian. More specifically, I want to look at the role of speech in this process, and its embeddedness in distinctive pedagogies of prayer that impact children's spiritual lives, and draw on language ideologies, because language, as Webkin argued, is central to one's faith and worship, because it mediates between a presupposed interiority, so how you are, your inner belief, and how good Christian you are or not in your interior, and its objectification and discursive form, yes? And especially in the Protestant version, speech is a marker of inner belief, right? Public speech is also extremely important for Syrian Christian churches in Kerala, because, and they pray and praise themselves with a rich tradition of oration and meditative discourses. And it's essential part. I mean, I don't know, in Caroline, social life is a very talkative life. People talk on every corner of the street, and politics are rhetorical. So rhetoric is a central part of this society, very similar to Tamil oratory, on which there are some very nice books written. I'll say one word about the church Alisha belongs to. It's the Jacobite Syrian Christian Church of India, which claims its ancient origin in, as I said, in the first century AD. And that's why they are also called Saint Thomas Christians, right? And they have been converted, they have been subjected to missionary activities from early 16th century Portuguese, so the Catholics, then Protestants, different Protestants, and every interaction came with more schisms. So from this community of St. Thomas Christians is now split into between 8 churches. Each church claims to be the true inheritor of St. Thomas, which reminds me very nicely of my fieldwork in Ukraine with 3 Orthodox and 1 Greek Catholic church, all claiming to be the true Kievan Patriarchate. She belongs to a church, to the Jacobite Church, which is one of the major ones. This community counts about 3 million people in Kerala, which is quite a lot for Kerala. It's very little for India, but it's about 19%. And it's a very rich and high caste community. And all 8 million together with the diaspora. So the diaspora is bigger than the community here, and they have a pattern of mobility, extremely interesting one. Now, she belongs to this church, which claims to be the Orthodox Church, and which was also split because of this of politics between an autochthonous Orthodoxy, so a church that claims to be the Indian Orthodox Church, and another church, her church, that wants to be to keep the Syrian connection. So they are under the Patriarchate of Antioch and recognize the Patriarch of Antioch. This is an ancient, a long tradition that they have. And in this church, pedagogies have been central to religious, like school pedagogies have been central to children's religious, became central to children's religious learning with the CMS missionaries in the reform in 19th centuries, which led to the Sunday school movement and to where Alisha belongs to. But in fact, before that, ritual pedagogies, and still ritual pedagogies, are extremely powerful. And in an Orthodox world, anthropologists have argued, the Christian self is very much shaped primarily in and through deference to ritual and tradition. So deferring authority to deferring authority to the church tradition, to church authority, ritual pedagogies, which are centered on liturgical practice, constitute the primary way for Syrian Christians to discover, practice, and live the faith. It's a liturgy-based, people have called it a liturgical catechism. Yes, it's a ritual-based pedagogy. Which means you just drag children to church and let them hang around the church and not bother too much to explain what's going on, right? Trusting that they will inhabit these rhythms of prayer and the sensorial world in which they experience, and in this way they will basically learn religion as an embodied habitus. A religious experience itself is a condition of skilled practice, of mastery, rather than conviction or adherence to a set of beliefs, yes? Ask a person what they believe. And in an elaborate ethnography of the Jacobite Church, maybe the only ethnography of this church, Susan Vishwanathan, an anthropologist from Delhi, argues that people's inner devotion is made manifest through posture, standing, and participating in collective worship. The quiet that he maintains, I'm quoting her, the vigor of his discipline, the stance of his posture, the alertness of his demeanor are all easily perceivable statements about his intention or disposition of the heart. And I have to shift between things because I didn't manage to with this to put them all in the same place. But I just want to give you a sense because some of you might be familiar with the some of you might be familiar with the Orthodox Church with Orthodox ritual in the Byzantine tradition. Just to give you a sense of where we are in Alicia's church. So you recite in the same rhythm with the whole liturgical performance, and ritual speech itself is less to be understood for its denotative content, so for what it means, but valued for its familiar forms. It is lived rather than comprehended, yes? And for this reason, many Orthodox churches have kept their sacred languages as liturgical language that are remote from everyday speech, like the Church Slavonic of Russian believers, for example. Syrian Christians in India have used Syriac for a long time, since it was close to Aramaic, and their connection to the Syriac churches in the Middle East, until the missionary reforms, when they shifted to Malayalam, but a lot of the words used in the liturgy are Syriac, so a lot of what remained in the liturgy is Syriac. And one of the reasons why I'm interested in them is that they shift now again back to Syriac, so kind of bringing back the mystery into the church and differentiating themselves into a very complicated political environment. They are returning to the Syriac, so teaching children in liturgy, but also in the Sunday school and teaching children Syriac. Now, what happens is that the CMS reforms, so the Anglican missionaries' reform, transformed the knowledge and practice of faith, and this is something that many people have been writing about, by textualizing ritual and tradition. So basically transforming what was a practice, right, transmitted mostly through interaction and participation, into text, yes? This had many implications for their religion, and people have been writing a lot about these things. And it also changed the pedagogies of prayer. Once you can read and you learn about the liturgy by reading about the liturgy, it's a very different experience that you have. However, as I argue in another article, the function of speech stayed the same, rather than shifting into a different language ideology, because the textbook culture of the Syrian Christian Sunday schools became centered on ritualized interactions and guided repetition. I wish I had the film to show you, but I didn't bring it. And the way, so the exchange in which people, in which children learn, in Sunday school is a ritualized interaction with text. They are, the Sunday school teacher reads from the text and they repeat what he reads, and then he asks them questions and they repeat the answer, and it's a cycle in which the text is the center, and they are learning by right by rote mostly. But what is more importantly is, and this is what one of the things I argue in more details in this article, is that what they learn is to trust each other. So it's a trusting an experience in which the success of this learning experience is when the teacher asks the right questions and the student provides the right answer. So this is all tied together, and I have an example in which in a Sunday school exam they gave the wrong question, and students failed miserably to answer basically on a prayer, reciting a prayer, but they chose the wrong part of the prayer, let's say, and students could not follow that up and could not recognize it. So it's what is important is that not the content doesn't matter that much as the right performance, yes? Which brings us very close to what ritual does, because in ritual, a ritual is successful and you're participating in ritual is successful if it is a right performance, yes, in this sense. And again, the textbook culture of the Sunday school is very much centered on ritualized interaction and guided repetition, very much, and this has been actually also the point of Christian missionaries, because the point was not to enlighten people very much, but to cultivate virtues, to cultivate values, to a different set of values to them. And it's also quite close, we can discuss this, to classical, like, religious textual-based pedagogies as learning Quran, right, for example, as a cultivation of virtues rather than understanding and reflecting on the content of it. So, basically, as Maurice Bloch and other people have argued, this kind of formalized, repetitive nature of ritual speech, which exists in rituals, but also, I argue, in the Sunday school education, involves a series of quotations. You always repeat someone else's words. As in liturgy, you repeat someone else's words all the time. In the same way, in the Sunday school, you repeat someone else's words. And in fact, you are not encouraged, if there is any time when you are using your own words, you have to signal that in advance. So if you look at the interactions, you have to signal that these are my words and they are different from that, yes? So it's a very clear frame, pragmatic frame for using the language. And one thing that this does is it separates intention and meaning of the action, because intention is not anymore yours. You repeat someone else's truth, right? And then there is no commitment to the truth of those statements. This is what deference means. You defer the truth and intention of the statements you reproduce to someone else. And that someone else can be the church fathers, or it can be the priest, or it can be the textbook. So the textbook becomes, in a similar way, an authority whose words you speak. Now, what it does is that it places intention and truth elsewhere, whether in a tradition, in the teacher, or a saint, or an exemplar, and then the felicitous performance, the successful performance, is assured by simply accurately reproducing the words rather than engaging with them. And it's this, so ritual speech defines then, I argue, not only ritual, but also the textbook culture. And the school Alicia attends, this school in fact, continues to reproduce this culture, insisting on memorization, recitation, and correct performance. In a longer conversation we had about the Sunday school pedagogy, Paidi, a well-experienced teacher in his 70s, observed that students learn prayer by heart through the recitation methods, which is used in Sunday school instruction, in prayer, in worship, and in ritual. So unlike the YMCA speech, Alicia's successful speech, which I'm going to show you in a second, that I have seen rehearsed and performed during every stage of half a year of all the stages of the Sunday school competition in her church, is a good illustration of the textbook culture and this quotation practice that I mentioned. And let me just show you briefly to understand where we are.
Okay.
സദൃശ്യവാക്യങ്ങൾ 16 24 വിശുദ്ധ മർക്കോ 1:32 ഉൽപ്പത്തി ആദ്യ പുസ്തകം 3:20
പിന്നീട് പാപം ചെയ്ത് ദൈവ തേജസ് നഷ്ടമാക്കിയ മുഴുവൻ മാനവരാശിയുടെയും വീണ്ടെടുപ്പിനായി സ്വർഗത്തിൽ നിന്നും ചൊരിഞ്ഞ ജീവന്റെ അപ്പമാണ് നമ്മുടെ കർത്താവും രക്ഷിതാവുമായി യേശു.
I'm having a lot of tension within me, but I'm not like showing it out. People from rural areas, they are very mature about what they speak and their speeches are very strong. For us, it's just like a friendly competition or something. For them, it's like a war.
നിങ്ങളെ വിളിച്ചിരിക്കുന്ന ദൈവം വിശ്വസ്തൻ. ഈ കൂട്ടായ്മയിൽ നിന്ന് അനുഭവ വേദ്യവും സുദൃഢവുമാകുന്നത് വിശുദ്ധ കുർബാനയിലൂടെയാണ്.
ത്രിയേക ദൈവത്തിന് സ്തുതി. ബഹുമാനപ്പെട്ട വൈദിക ശ്രേഷ്ഠർക്കും അധ്യാപകർക്കും മാതാപിതാക്കൾക്കും കൂട്ടുകാർക്കും എന്റെ വന്ദനം. ഇന്നെനിക്കിവിടെ പ്രസംഗിക്കുവാൻ ലഭിച്ചിരിക്കുന്ന വിഷയം സ്വർഗത്തിൽ നിന്നും ഇറങ്ങി വന്ന ജീവനുള്ള അപ്പം എന്നുള്ളതാണ്. യേശു അപ്പമെടുത്ത് സ്തോത്രം ചെയ്ത മുറിച്ച തന്റെ ശിഷ്യന്മാർ കൊടുത്തുകൊണ്ട് അവരോട്, ഇത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് വേണ്ടി നൽകപ്പെട്ടിരിക്കുന്ന എന്റെ ശരീരമാകും, എന്റെ ഓർമ്മയ്ക്കായി ഇത് നിങ്ങൾ ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കണം. വിശുദ്ധ കുർബാന വഴിയായി കർത്താവിന്റെ ശരീരരക്തങ്ങൾ ഭക്ഷിക്കുകയും അവന് വാഗ്ദാനം ചെയ്ത നൽവരങ്ങൾക്ക് നമുക്ക് അർഹരായി തീരുവാൻ സാധിക്കട്ടെ എന്ന് പ്രാർത്ഥിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് എന്റെ ഏവാക്കൾ ഞാൻ നിർത്തുന്നു. ദൈവത്തിൽ നാം മാത്രം മട്ടുപെടുമാറാകട്ടെ.
This speech on the bread of life, let me see where she is. This speech on the bread of life is a speech that she rehearsed for 6 months. And I've been through this. In fact, there is a short film online called The Bread of Life, in which follows Alicia through this experience. And this is just an excerpt from that film. The speech was prepared by the Sunday school headmaster. It was a compilation of spiritual quotes from various people, theological references on the topic of Jesus as the bread of life, which is what everybody was addressing. And her task was to learn it by heart, reproduce it closely to achieve a perfect performance. The right expression, gesturing, correct pronunciation of the old Malayalam terms, as you see, this was in Malayalam, amplitude, tone of voice, all made for passionate speech with carefully chosen modulations that seemed natural, even though they were rehearsed many times. In doing so, she consciously deferred the authority and meaning of the words she was uttering and concentrating exclusively on getting them right. Yes, so the point is really getting them right. She also admitted afterwards that the speech didn't touch her at all. Now, this ritualized performance reflects not only the broader textbook culture of the Sunday school, so the way they prepare them in the Sunday school for these speeches and how they are evaluated, but also how this practice feeds from and supports the orthopraxy of ritual. Liturgical practices, prayers and songs are taught and rehearsed in the Sunday school. In fact, the first prayers the children learn and the first songs from the first grade in the Sunday school are liturgical prayers. So they feed into one another. You become better at the liturgy by being good in school and reciting and learning things in school. And contextualized in the Sunday school competition. So unlike the failed speech, this successful speech, this one, included a liturgical song that she sang beautifully right before concluding. Appropriately, the song was an Eucharistic song, right? Which reflected directly on the topic of the elocution. The Lord said, I'm the bread of life, was the song. And I have, in fact, there is an interesting reflection on the way she plays in this discourse with apam, the bread of life, and apam is basically the daily bread, which is not properly, not really bread in South India, and plays with these two registers quite nicely. Now, the formalism of the liturgical song converges with the formalism of the prepared speech to assure a successful performance, and in fact, there is an intertextuality, right, between the liturgical language, the liturgical speech, and the text, the textbook. Or the speech in this case. In this context, we can better understand how the extempore speech, so the failed speech, raises difficulties for Alicia compared to the usual elocution context like this one, which she lost, but she won many others. Her mom also remarked after the YMCA competition that they, the group representing their Sunday school, were not really prepared for this type of context, and they learned differently. The YMCM contest, on the other hand, forces children to improvise quickly on a given topic, seek for convincing examples to illustrate their case, something that requires a very different type of training, but I would argue also a different type of interiority, or expressing your interiority of speech and using speech. So it is a speech genre which encourages personal intention and the performance of sincerity. So the whole idea of the speech is to find examples from your own life, express them, and in this way signal that this is a sincere speech that reflects your intentions and your beliefs, right? And this is inspired by the Protestant ideal of sincerity, which takes speech as an expression of inner belief. As Webkin argues about Calvinist missionaries, sincere speech became a marker of true belief. Protestant prayers should come from the heart, spontaneous and truly felt, that is, they should be sincere. Yes. This ideal gained ground in recent years, interestingly, so not with the Sunday schools, which are of Protestant origin, but in fact, as I argue at length in a paper, they were appropriated and used by the Syrian Christian elite, and this is what happened in the Coptic Church also. So the Sunday schools, the pedagogical methods were taken by the church elites and made to educate people, but not necessarily in the same ways in which they were intended to be. So this idea of sincere speech gained ground in recent years, becoming extremely popular after, interestingly, the charismatic Catholic revival. There's been a huge charismatic revival in South India, and Kerala has been swept basically by this, with retreat centers gathering thousands and thousands of people, a TV station that runs 24 hours, and everybody being transformed on that. The charismatic revival in Kerala has been stronger than the Pentecostal or the Protestant evangelical one. Now, many Syrian Christians started to embrace this style also and search for ways to cultivate it within or in parallel with the church, to which they continue to have strong family and caste allegiances. So well, this is important, that religion in this sense, and there's, I don't have time to talk about it, but we can discuss it in later on. Patriarchy, caste, and religion are tied together here, right? So this is a jatit, it's a caste defined by the religion, and it works very much like that. There are no intermarriages with any other Christians, including Catholic Christians, who come from Dalits or from the lower castes, or anything like that. To contain this kind of change, so the fact that many people have became interested in this sincere speech, yes, and exploration of interiority and discovering their own interiority, Syrian Christian churches established their own retreat centers modeled on the charismatic version. And some Sunday schools also adopted spontaneous, what they call spontaneous prayer. Yes, so this is not the canonical prayer, which they pray at home. So at home, the evening or the morning prayer means that the patriarch of the church stands there with the prayer book, from a printed prayer book, and reads, and children respond, the wife responds, and then this is how it goes. It's basically a mini version of the liturgy. So they adopted what they call spontaneous prayer and speech as part of the pedagogical practice, and try to give space to the youth to practice it. So some Sunday schools, yes? And in this sense, within the church itself, within Alicia's church, a distinction was made between canonical or written prayer. They call it, so it's called both ways, prartana, written or canonical, and spontaneous, what they call spontaneous prayer. However, what they refer to as spontaneous prayer is not really the charismatic version, right, in which you spell out everything that is to be spelled out, but it's a petitionary prayer. So children are asked to come in front before a Sunday school assembly and pray for the assembly, pray for something, right? But and if sometimes even the service, and make short personalized prayer requests. But as I try to see, even this kind of petitionary prayer tries to bring back, so to recenter the intention to the speaker. The speaker who has to find his or her own words, and emphasizes a self-contained personhood rather than, so he speaks for the others but speaks from the position of a speaker addressing the others, rather than a mediator of a tradition or mediator of ritual or a mediator of liturgy or the church. Learning to become more confident in spontaneous prayer of speech is a process that requires this recentering inwards and stresses slightly more, even though not in the Protestant forms, individual agency. It also undermines the canonical form and all pedagogical model by tending to regard the speaker, and so this kind of transition also made inroads into how people look at the speaker, yes? The speaker of sincere, transparent language is being superior to the one who recites. And this has a long history in the history of Orthodoxy, from Russia to anywhere else, where Orthodoxy has always been, Eastern Christianity has always been accused of being formalized, of using this formalized speech, canonical and all this stuff. And, as Roy, an extremely charismatic and successful Sunday school director from this church, and preacher mentioned in a compelling plea for spontaneous prayer, it says, the written prayers alone are not prayer. Prayer should be samsara, conversation with God. We should talk to God. In the sense that it is a talk in which we plead before and share our views with God. That's far away from the canonical right forms. Of course, he is practicing that, and he is one of the people who has this charismatic influence and is a speaker who is asked to speak everywhere in the church. But what is important to emphasize at this point is that the more modest petitionary prayer that children do, I pray for the success in exams, to have success in exams, that's an important thing. I pray for the my family to be healthy, blah, blah, blah. My father not to be moved to a different town to work. And the charismatic, this kind of spontaneous prayers that are grounded in the same pedagogical vision, that an Orthodox, an interiority, a Christian interiority, is shaped by learning to speak with your own words. So finding and speaking with your own words rather than quoting other people, right? Whether in prayer or in speech. And thus they represent a shift from ritual speech. Now let me return once again towards the end
to Alicia's failed speech at YMCA, which, as I realized afterwards, was flanked by two other speeches in Malayalam. So she spoke in English, they spoke, and this says something about the language of speech. So Malayalam as the language of ritual, or Syria, English as the language of the middle classes, it's the language of competition and successfulness in life, throughout India, but not, so not only for this. And she goes to an Indian, to an English middle class school, secular school too, secular, whatever that means in that context. So an Orthodox boy who came after her to speak on the same topic, which witnessing Jesus in the modern world, started, the boy from the countryside as you call it, started by arguing against the modern tendency to become self-centered. To find a good path, he said, we have to take the example of our Orthodox patriarchs, who are the models of true Christians to be followed. Only by attending the liturgy, listening to their words, can we lead a good life. He claimed, basically echoing the whole Sunday school textbook and education, which says a believer should pray through the church, through the words of the church, yes? Which defines the old way of the ritual or the Sunday school, the textbook-based pedagogy, the textbook culture of the Sunday school. The opposite came from another contestant, a girl, who emphasized in a persuasive manner that inner conversion is in fact the path to true Christian life. The born-again experience that makes one a true witness of Jesus Christ and testifying about it. Alicia, with her awkward example about the friend who died too young because she didn't really stay close to God, was nowhere in between these two, or somewhere in between these two. Now, the contrast between this type of interiority, basically the this distinction between them was, I realized later on while looking with my research assistant and friend through the interviews in Malayalam, and where he was pointing out that in fact, look, the girl's speech was really an expression of the inner faith that he has and how consolidated that is compared to the other ones who simply recite with the voice of others. I have a lengthy quote from him, but I'm not going to. It's different from common speech competitions where verbalism, vocabulary, amplitude of voice are all applied in a systematic manner just to score more points. So he was really making visible this distinction between sincere, true speech as an expression of inner belief versus the other. Now the contrast between these types of interiority observed by him in the girl's sincere speech and one shaped to correct performance seemed obvious to him, and he valued the first as an expression of true faith. Speech is crucial to both. In fact, it's absolutely necessary, right, to express things, and it's crucial to forming a Christian interiority, but to the extent to which it remains subject to the pragmatic context of performance, it can create confusing expectations. The ritualized speech of liturgical worship or Sunday school recitation shapes an Orthodox person who through canonical forms, while spontaneous speech shifts emphasis to the individual subject who must find her own voice by disentangling herself from the voice of others. The voice of the patriarch, the voice of the father, the voice of the ritual speech, the voice of the Sunday school headmaster, and all the other voices. And it's a lot of work to disentangle yourself from these things. This is where Alicia's difficulties came from, revealing the confusing ethos of prayer in which they are asked to find their own voice while rehearsing the words of others. I said already that the difficulty in finding a Christian, her interior, Christian interiority in the shifting landscape of Christian faith in South India. A person who speaks from elsewhere, that is with the words of others, can hardly look or find his inner voice. Syrian Christians today try to find their voice between the quest for an inner spirituality, in very much mirroring the trends in South India, and the orthopraxy of faith and maintaining the orthopraxy of faith. Thank you.
Thank you.
Vlad for his great speech.